We are talking about the AI, or we are talking about content marketing in general? Yeah, incidentally, I have definitely met 2-3 companies which are trying to do chatbot-related customer support. So my friend Ramesh is sitting in the back. I visited him. He is from a startup. He's hosted in IIIT Bangalore. And one of another company which is hosted in IIIT Bangalore is exactly doing this. So they are a company which has created this chatbot-based customer support. That is one example which I have seen. Also, there's one more company in which Funny invested. They are also into similar field where any company which wants to create a customer support-related content, they can create a core offer a company. So for example, any services company can create a core offer, or a product company can create a Quora for its own company, where you can go and post some questions, and either somebody, another user of that particular product, or if nobody from the users are answering it, maybe the company's customer support executive can answer it. And they are also trying to build some artificial intelligence into that. So already this has started, and I'm pretty sure it's gonna, you know, it's both scary as well as exciting. So we all have to see how this ride is going to take.
I think that pretty much covers the AI part. Chatbots and also virtual personal assistants, even into the future in the Google Home product. I'll just leave it to everyone's imagination what they can do in terms of being intelligent assistants for personal use. And similar technologies can be replicated to B2B as well. If the company's sales or company's information is in the CRM, and if there is a system which can then intelligently analyze it, like Praveen was mentioning, you know, and tell you, let's say in the email list, ABC are much more likely to open my next email and read. So those sort of changes. So it will be a assistant to the CMO as well in terms of marketing.
All I can say is I would like to see one post before I decide whether I should look for another career. So I'm still waiting, because writing is not something just about language. It is also a lot of emotion involved, so much culture involved, and so many different approaches. And how somebody can have a robot which can do all that, is if it is really there, then I would really, I think, fall in love with it. I have nothing else to say.
So I would also like to add one more example. This is another company by my friend in Canada. So these guys are also into AI, and they have targeted the higher ed sector. When we say higher ed, the universities in the US, UK, and other places. So they have mapped out the entire student life cycle. It starts from the minute somebody registers on the website of a university asking for a query about admission, to all the way till they graduate and also stay in touch with the university as an alum. In this entire process, there is always a leakage. So if you see the number of people who query, to number of people you apply, and number of people who get admitted, to number of people who actually join, there is a lot of fallout. Even if you see in the US, especially in the undergrad level, one of the major metric is how many students have graduated in 4 years, right? So it's a 4-year degree, but number of people who gradually takes the data from existing student profile and also maybe alum profiles as well, and gives a prediction on what applicant or which applicant should be given admission. And given an admission, which applicant has more probability of joining the course and also completing the course over a period of 4 years or 6 years or whatever. So that is another very important, very relevant and apt application of the AI that I have seen, where they're mapping the entire customer lifecycle, not only the marketing portion or customer support portion.
Yeah, one thing is what I write next would always be something that can keep me up at night, especially when it comes to representing the technology for which I write. The reason being, it is developing at the speed of thought. It's changing, morphing. So what worked before will not work now. Similarly with the legislation that covers these applications, that is another thing that is really important to keep in touch with. And then of course, how you tell your story. Like, there are so many ways that you can tell your stories. You know, you have nowadays infographics. People started using infographics a lot, and now people are moving to more audio video content. and then something else, embedded videos in your written content, so many different things. How exactly do you write stuff? Okay, and also the veracity of what you're writing at that point in time. Obviously, you're dating all your content for a particular reason, because if somebody says, I said this on that day, but you be very sure that on that day it is completely authentic. That is a very, very important part of content creation.
Again, I can speak from a promoter's perspective, because those are the people whom I work with a lot. The challenge right now is there's a lot of challenge in terms of measurement and managing as well. If I have multiple, and this is especially true for businesses who have multiple channels from where they're getting their leads and customers from. It's a challenge to measure them across platforms. It's a challenge to, and hence value things differently. For example, what is the value of a TV advertisement versus a YouTube ad versus something in the branding space, example. There's no easy way to measure, and so that is one. But that seems to be the biggest challenge. And in the lead gen world, it's again, if I have different channels, then how do I manage them more efficiently, and how do I measure them so that I can allot my resources to them accordingly? So that is the challenge. In most cases, they are. The challenge is more about, it's not about advertisers feeling that their ROI is not meeting. That's, in my view, a bit slightly misplaced. The challenge is more about realizing what is valuable and what is not. That sort of distinction is not there, because as a business owner, as a CMO, I might have my objectives for my business, but just by simply turning off my TV ads for a day, I can't A-B test and say whether TV ads are effective or not. It's more of, but rather the question should be, what percentage of my budget should go for TV? And to answer this, I need to have a handle on how important TV is for my business, and what is it that is actually delivering. So I think all channels are valuable in their own way, but how do you value, how do you manage is slightly very contextual. So that's my take. But this is there. The measurement is a challenge. A lot of things, they're on the rise. The spend is only growing up. You can follow this. I think this debate is already on YouTube between Rajan Anandan and Star India CEO. Rajan Anandan is Google India head, and Star Group, he's not the CEO, I think he's the MD. This talk was in ISB again. This panel discussion was in ISB, so you can search for it. And they have given you all the high level data points about offline and online. And the takeaway is that both of them are growing. And of course, both of them are making case for their own channels, but it seems that both of them are on the rise, and online is set to grow at a higher pace as of now. Now, to your question of how should a marketer decide? Again, see, we can't give answers, because we can't be prescriptive to anyone. It depends a lot on your parameters. It depends, like I said, the questions that marketers should ask is, what is this channel and how does it help me? Just have that framework in place and then make your decisions. And to aid any marketer in that, now there are tools and big companies to startups. Again, I just keep emphasizing this point again. They're trying to solve for it. They're trying to make marketers' lives easier by addressing this problem of measurement and how do you assign value to your channels.